Hello, good evening everybody. I am Sister Sangeeta Biswal, Senior Nursing Officer, Respiratory ICU, AIIMS Bhubaneswar. Today my topic is on ventilator care and nurses' role. Coming to the objectives of my session, at the end of the session, the participants will be able to acquire knowledge on mechanical ventilation and nursing management of a COVID-19 positive patient on mechanical ventilation. Now there is one question, what is invasive mechanical ventilation? Before going to this question, let us understand how many types of mechanical ventilation are there. There are two types, that is non-invasive and another is invasive. Non-invasive mode of mechanical ventilation includes your BiPAP and CPAP. But in invasive mode of mechanical ventilation, you have to give mechanical ventilation by an endotracheal tube. And you have to intubate the patient by putting an endotracheal tube into the trachea. Now question comes, how the ventilator gives support in invasive mechanical ventilation? Invasive mechanical ventilation is a form of life support measure with positive pressure ventilation. Now here I have kept a picture of a ventilator. This ventilator is of Nellcor Puritan Bennett ventilator. It's a top end variant which I am using in my unit, that is respiratory unit of AIIMS Bhubaneswar. Usually when you come across the ventilator or when you receive a patient on ventilator, we just think really it's a very difficult job to handle a ventilator. But I am telling you, it's very simple as your mobile phone. You can operate it very easily if you know some basic settings. This ventilator has three parts. The first part is the screen. In the screen, you can view all the settings of your patient and how your patient is performing during mechanical ventilation. The middle part is the assembling unit. In this assembling unit, you are going to connect the circuit and other accessories needed for mechanical ventilation. In the bottom part, there is the compressor. And the compressor generates medical air. Now in the back of the ventilator, there are two tubings, one for medical air and another for oxygen hose pipe. You are connecting those tubings to the source of medical air and another for oxygen source. There will be a power cord for power, so you can connect all those things before starting your ventilator. Now, what we have done, we have already chosen the ventilation type, that is invasive mode of mechanical ventilation. There are some sub modes of invasive mechanical ventilation. Whether you have chosen a ventilator of top end variant or a low end variant, you can find minimum three type of configuration or three type of mode of mechanical, that is invasive mechanical ventilation. These are spontaneous. Next one is SIMV, that is synchronized intermittent mechanical ventilation, and the last one is assist or control type of ventilation. In control ventilation, you are going to control the tidal volume or the pressure. Now we'll discuss all these modes of ventilation one by one. So the first mode of ventilation is spontaneous mode of mechanical ventilation. What happens here? Patient breathes spontaneously. The machine is not giving any pressure breath. The patient needs only specific FiO2 to maintain its normal blood gases. So basically it's a winning mode. When you are going to win the patient from the ventilator, then you are trying for spontaneous ventilation. Next mode is SIMV, that is synchronized intermittent mechanical ventilation. The machine allows the patient to breathe spontaneously while providing present FiO2 and a number of ventilator breaths to ensure adequate ventilation without fatigue. During this ventilation, if patient gets tired and cannot breathe or cannot maintain all these normal parameters what we have set on the ventilator, then the machine starts supporting the patient. The third and most important mode of ventilation is assist and control type of ventilation. In this mode, the machine is programmed to deliver a set tidal volume and set respiratory rate. The client is given a full mechanical support. There is no participation in the ventilation from patient side. If your patient is critically ill, you can safely go for this type of or this mode of ventilation. There are some important points that we have to remember when we are going to initiate an invasive mechanical ventilation. First one is selection of ventilator circuit, which is checked for any leakage prior to connection. Then next one is two HME filter, that is heat moist exchanger or bacterial filter, must be used in the circuit, and one catheter mount is also used at the appropriate place of the circuit. One sterile expiratory filter must be fitted appropriately in the assembling unit. Other safety accessories like closed suction or continuous suction set and a closed nebulizer must be attached to the circuit. Now let us see how we can initiate invasive mechanical ventilation in a ventilator. In picture number 1, there is a ventilator, so we have to switch on the ventilator. Like your mobile phone, there is a power button. You have to press the power button so that you can start your ventilator. In the picture number 2, it's showing ventilator setup is in progress. Now the ventilator will ask you whether you want to go to the previous setting or a new setting for a new patient. Now we have chosen the next option, that is new patient setting. Now we are going for a fresh setting. Once you are going for that, the ventilator will ask you what type of ventilation you want to give to your patient. I have chosen an invasive type of ventilation. Next, it will ask you what is the body weight of your patient. That value you have to give. Then next, you have to choose one appropriate mode of ventilation. That may be your spontaneous, that may be your SIMB, or assist or control mode of ventilation. As per the patient need, you are going to choose the mode of ventilation. Here I have chosen assist and control mode of ventilation. In control, I have controlled the tidal volume of the patient. Now you have to continue. How we can continue? In picture number 4, there is a black color round button. This is called the knob of the ventilator. This master button, you can rotate in clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. If you are rotating in the anti-clockwise direction, you can decrease the parameter range. If you are rotating it in the clockwise direction, you can increase the parameter range. Once you have accepted it, then all the setting will be final for your patient, and it will come in the ventilator screen like in picture number 5. Now your ventilator will write on the top of the screen that I am waiting for the patient to get connected. Now successfully we have applied the setting in our ventilator. So how we'll deliver the mechanical ventilation? We need a ventilator circuit and some accessories to set up a closed ventilator circuit system. So for that we need, first one is ventilator circuit. The ventilator circuit has two limbs. One is inspiratory limb, another is expiratory limb. The inspiratory limb will get connected to the inspiratory port, which is available in the assembling unit of the ventilator, and the expiratory limb will get connected to the expiratory filter, which is already present in the assembling unit of the ventilator. The next one is your catheter mount. The catheter mount is the connecting link between the ventilator circuit and the ET tube of patient. Next one is your bacterial filter or HME filter, that is heat and moist exchanger. We are using two HME filter in the circuit. Next one is your nebulizer. This is a T nebulizer or a fogger we are using in the closed circuit system. Next one is your expiratory filter. This expiratory filter is already fitted in the assembling unit of the ventilator. You are in the critical care unit. Now you are going to receive a patient who needs mechanical ventilation. You got an information that a patient is coming from the casualty, a patient is coming from the COVID unit or the isolation unit who needs the mechanical ventilation, and the patient is COVID positive. So what is the recommended adjustment or recommended setting over the ventilator?
An ultra-protective mechanical ventilation, that is ARDS setting, should be applied for a COVID positive patient initially. The table shows there are some parameters and there is some desirable range. First one is tidal volume. The tidal volume you have to keep at very low range, that is 4 to 6 ml per kg of body weight. For other patient, we used to prefer a tidal volume about 8 ml per kg of body weight. Next one is PEEP. PEEP we are keeping at a high range, that is 8 to 10 cm of water. For other patient, we used to start the PEEP about 5 cm of water. We are keeping a plateau pressure below 24 cm of water in the ARDS setting. For the respiratory rate setting, we are preferring a range between 16 to 18 breaths per minute, that is normal breaths we have to set. Next is FiO2. FiO2 will support the saturation of the patient. We are keeping a range between 45 to 50% in the ventilator. After 1 hour, you go for ABG. If your values are still abnormal, then you change the existing parameter over the ventilator. Now, this picture shows how we are delivering mechanical ventilation in a closed circuit system. We have used a test lung instead of a patient. So, the ventilator circuit has two limbs. One is inspiratory limb, another is expiratory limb. The inspiratory limb is getting connected to the inspiratory port of the assembling unit of the ventilator. Similarly, the expiratory limb is getting connected to the expiratory filter, and in between them, there is a HME filter. Next to the ventilator circuit, we are attaching the second HME. And after this HME filter, we are connecting the nebulizer, that is the T-piece nebulizer. To the nebulizing T-piece, we are connecting a catheter mount. This catheter mount is getting connected to the ET tube of the patient. And by this circuit, we are going to deliver the mechanical ventilation to the patient in a safe manner.
During mechanical ventilation, there are some risk procedures for a COVID positive patient who is on mechanical ventilation. First one is open suctioning of respiratory tract, and next one is nebulization, and next is chest compression or CPR. All these procedures will be explained one by one. Usually in the critical care unit, if your patient is intubated and patient is on mechanical ventilation, you are going for open suctioning. If you are going for open suctioning, it generates a lot of erosion into the environment, which exposure is really dangerous and may spread the infection to the healthcare members. But if we are going for a continuous suction or closed suction, this erosion may not get generated into the environment. So what are the objectives if we are using this continuous suction or closed suction set in the circuit? The objectives are to preserve the PEEP, to prevent aerosol generation, to ensure a patent airway. Already I have shown you, we have connected a nebulization T-piece or a fogger in the circuit. A closed circuit nebulizer is highly recommended. You have to clamp the catheter mount, put nebulization solution into the nebulizer, then you release the clamp and start nebulization. In the next slide, there is a picture showing how we are giving nebulization. In this picture, I am showing how we are giving nebulization in the closed circuit system. There is a catheter mount. First, you have to clamp the catheter mount at the middle of the catheter mount. Then the fogger has to be opened, and in that fogger, you have to instill the desired amount of nebulizing solution and close the port of the fogger. Then switch on the nebulization and release the clamp. Now your patient will get nebulization in the closed circuit system. The next high risk procedure is the chest compression or CPR. It is highly aerosol generating procedure. So we have to take some special precaution and we have to don proper PPE. Cover the nose area of the patient with a gauze pad during CPR and continue mechanical ventilation during the CPR and you should not switch off your ventilator during the CPR.
During mechanical ventilation, you may face some troubles. These are the emergency situation during mechanical ventilation. If we are not going to attend those things, then it may lead mechanical failure or failure in mechanical ventilation. So how we'll identify these all problems? There is some system like alarms. When there is a problem in delivering mechanical ventilation, the ventilator used to give some alarms. This alarm used to come in form of some color, and some written instruction used to come over the screen. So there is some alarms which are coming in red light or red color. So first one is circuit disconnect alarm. Next one is low oxygen alarm, that is low supply of oxygen alarm. And third one is high peak pressure in the circuit. These three alarm used to come in red light. The fourth one is AC power loss and compressor inoperative. The fourth one used to come in yellow light. So what is the troubleshooting measures that nurses has to take? That will be discussed in the next slide.
So already we have seen there are some alarms in the previous slide. So there are some red color alarms and there are some yellow color alarms. If alarm coming in red color, you should not ignore it. So first red color alarm is circuit disconnection. If your circuit has disconnected, immediately you have to reconnect the circuit. Next one is low oxygen concentration or low supply of oxygen. So immediately you have to change the source of oxygen supply. Next one is high peak pressure. As your ventilator is giving positive pressure ventilation, if there is any blockage, so immediately it will give an alarm of high peak pressure. So what you have to do? Immediately you go for suctioning or blockage removal. Next one is your AC power loss and compressor inoperative. If your power fails, then compressor will not work. So what you have to do? Immediately you have to provide a power backup to the ventilator. The nursing management of patient on mechanical ventilation. Special attention must be given to the patient on mechanical ventilation to prevent any potential complication. The alarms coming over the ventilator screen must not be ignored. The patient must be in sedation according to the hospital protocol to prevent agitation or restlessness. Why we are giving sedation here? If your patient will be restless, he may pull out the ET tube or ventilator circuit, which may disturb the mechanical ventilation process. Two HME filters must be fitted in the circuit, one in between the ventilator circuit and the catheter mount, and another one between expiratory filter and the expiratory limb of the ventilator circuit. Change catheter mount and HME filter in 5 to 7 days interval or if they are visibly soiled. As per the infection control protocol, we used to change HME filter and catheter mount in every 3 days interval. But here, in case of COVID patient, we have to limit the aerosol exposure to the health workers. So we have to change the catheter mount and HME filter after day 5. This is all about my topic, that is ventilator care and nurse's role. If you have any doubt or any question related to my topic, you can chat me on the chat box and I will get back to you. Thank you.